sacrifice, so one teaser. All I have to you I give. All I have to you I give. You were broken for the broken. You laid down your life that I might live. Sacrifice so undeserved. All I am to you I give. You know, sometimes there's feedback in our lives that tries to prevent us from worshiping Jesus. Isn't that right? But there's, you know, the words above all the noise, the words of praise, declaration of what God is doing today are more powerful and stronger than anything like that. So as we continue to worship, let's just think about how powerful and how great our God is and how worthy of praise He is, no matter what noise is going on.
Unreserved and unrestrained, Your love is wild, it's wild for me. So I worship You, Jesus. We worship You right now, Lord. Your love is wild, it's wild for me. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, You have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into Your family. Your blood flows through my veins.
Sing that again for my mother's.
From my mother's womb, You have chosen me.
We're chosen. Been born again
into a family. Your blood flows through my veins. Sing it out. I'm no longer. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Declare that this morning. I'm no longer.
Wow, let's give it up for Keith and Sephora.
Give it up to Jesus.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. My name is Brandon Kress. Alongside me is my beautiful, inspiring wife, Cassie. And we are here to welcome you all. We are so excited to see each and every one of you here today. God has something very special for you today. With that also being said, we would like to welcome our Facebook friends and family that are all over. And welcome them. Let's give it up for them. Also, if you're here for the first time, we'd like to give it up for you too. Welcome. If you are here for the first time and you haven't filled out one of these Connect cards, we would ask before you leave today to fill out the back of the Connect card, and you can drop it in the back in our tithe boxes. This is an opportunity so that we get to know you a little bit better. Pastor Greg would like to write a little note to you, and we have a little gift for you. So if you could do that, that would be awesome.
This coming Saturday, February 25th, we're having our Women's Sweat and Scripture. We had to push it back a week, so now even more of you have an opportunity to join us with no excuses. This is a great time to get connected with the ladies in our church. We're going to have a Bible study, a great workout on the beach with our very own Katie McCrath, followed by brunch and fellowship. Again, it's February 25th at 8 a.m. at Hollywood Beach on Harrison Street. Please join us for a great time and make sure you sign up at the Welcome Center.
Awesome. Thank you, my love. We also have the Spring Fest coming up. Leon and his beautiful wife are going to be heading that. Spring Fest is an opportunity that we will be able to connect with our community, and this event will bring hopefully everyone from the community. We're asking for your help to invite them. This will be an opportunity with games, prizes, and fun things for the kids, but most of all, we're going to be able to deliver the gospel to the community, and that is something to praise God about. So let's give it up for that. If you are interested, we need an army of people to help us put this on. So in front here, you will we have the Welcome Center. After you leave today, if God calls you to do this, put your name down there. Don't have to have a lot of qualifications. Just put your name, and we'll help you and guide you through that. But you'll get to see God work in and through the church and the community. So we're super excited about that. Next Sunday will be an opportunity for those of you who may have just started coming to church or within the last week or so, or you would like to get to know a little bit about the church's vision through Pastor Greg, opportunity for us to get to meet you and ultimately have some food. So if you are interested, we will be having this next Sunday right after service, right outside these doors here on the other side here. And so if you're interested, please join us next Sunday for that. In the meantime, look to your left, look to your right, say hi to five people.
And good morning, everybody. Welcome to the cross. Can we give Jesus a hand one more time for what he's doing here? If you think the mic is cutting out on me, it's actually my voice. But but I'm good and I'm here. And we got a special teacher today, Josh. I asked him before I even got sick this week. So Josh, Pastor Josh, who's on our team, he's going to be teaching us. We're looking forward to that. It's going to be awesome. I'm going to tell you right now. Yeah, you can make some more noise for that, please. Because he always brings it, and he's got a word from the Lord for you. Can I just say that I want Jesus to increase in my life, and I need to decrease. You know, that's a verse we shared with our team this morning. He must increase and I must decrease, John the Baptist said. And I hope that we as a church would take that on. That not just in here, you guys, but that we would go out in these, your job, in the streets, wherever you live, whatever you got going on, and that the Lord would increase in you to a point where you want to see others come to know him. That you want to see others come to understand his love for them. And that I believe that the more he is increased in us, the more you are going to be an effective and powerful church in this community. And I am excited about this outreach, just the Spring Fest. I pray that you would let the Lord use you to be a part of that. So we are excited to see what he's going to do. Are you with me? Let him increase and let him increase in us. Amen? Yeah. Hey, we take a moment in between high-pitched voices breaks. We take a moment and we pray. And so we're going to pray for a lot of different things. You know, there's some praise reports. Somebody's praising God for moms and their hard work. We're praising God that Lance got a full-time job. Give it up for Lance. Yeah. His girl Felicia's praising the Lord for that. So she's like, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But prayer requests, people closing on their house. Sorry. Healing, you know, cancer strikes so many different places. And we have a friend who has a friend named Dora, and she needs healing from cancer. And she's on her second chemo treatment. And then we have another friend. He has got, man, a lot of friends who have cancer. There's Rick, he's got bone cancer. Chris's got colon cancer. Tom's got throat cancer. Danielle's got breast cancer. Martin's got cancer. We want to lift up all these people because you know what I love is that our God, Jesus, is the same today as he was yesterday and forevermore. And we trust that he can heal just like he healed the man with the withered hand. I was just reading that this morning. You know, he said, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, not because it was just not working it properly for a moment and then all of a sudden it got fixed. No, no, no. He healed him of a problem with his hand from many years. And so here is this guy with a withered hand, and here he stretches it out and is healed. That's the same Jesus that we can go to today, that we're going to stand together and pray to and ask him for health, for healing. There's people praying for this family. You know, they had a loved one, a part of our team, Steve Lawson, his mom passed away. And then his sister-in-law, you guys know we've been praying for Tara. It's a miracle what's happening in her life. They're putting her skull back on this week. But they've been going through an emotional roller coaster, you know. You mourn with those who mourn. You rejoice with those who rejoice. They're experiencing right now. So we want to lift up the Lawson and Hernandez family. And then, of course, we're praying for marriages. And we're praying as well for just complete health. There's somebody's mom that needs health. Family financials and stability and just a stronger relationship with the Lord. Man, that's one of the greatest prayer requests you could have. And then praying for others that their hearts would be open and their eyes would be open to hear the voice of the Lord. And they're praying for their family and friends. So let's stand together. Let's take a moment as a church to pray. I'm going to ask some of our elder team and some of our guys, if you wouldn't mind coming down front, if you'd like somebody to lay hands on you and pray for you, maybe you're dealing with cancer, maybe you got something going on, we definitely would want you to get prayed for if you, in fact, are a part of this team. we don't want to miss out on this family getting prayed for. So if you're here, you want prayer, come on down. This is not a, oh my goodness, I'm going to get prayed for and now I'm going to fall over or something. No, no, no. This is just, we're praying for you and we're praying for God to do whatever it is that he knows what needs to be done in your life. And at the same time, as a church, what we do is we gather together as two or more gather together, and we know he's in the midst of us. And at the same time, if we touch on those things together, man, we not only know he hears us, he's going to answer our cry. So let's pray together. If you want prayer, come on down. This would be your time. Don't miss out. Father, we thank you for these prayer requests, and we thank you that you are hearing the heart of everybody in this house today. And God, we thank you that, Lord, nothing is impossible with you. We give you praise and honor for all the things that you have done, for jobs that were provided, for moms that are out there, God, for healings that have happened, Lord. And God, we want to come to you now and just beg you and beseech you, God, for these people that have a need, Lord, whether it's Dora that has a cancer, God, we pray for healing, and all these other peoples that were listed by one of our team. Lord, we pray for these treatments, the cancer. God, more than anything, we know you have power over everything. Lord, you touched the man who was blind, the man who was lame. You touched the widow, the woman that had the issue of blood, and they were healed. And so we come to you, Jesus, and we thank you that you are the same today as you were for in the past, and you will be forever. And we thank you, God, that we can trust you, that nothing is impossible with you. So we say, Lord, please, may you pour out your grace and your mercy and heal these people. God, may you do a miraculous work. Give them encouragement. Give them strength as they deal through chemo. Give them strength as they go through whatever impact they may have on their life. But Lord, help them to trust you no matter what. God, we lift up all the marriages. We lift up all the problems that are going on. We pray, God, may you heal the marriages in this house. May you bring just love, and may love cover a multitude of sins. May marriages be restored, rejoice. God, we thank you that, Lord, nothing is impossible with you. Lord, we lift up all these prayer requests. You know their names. You know what's going on. We thank you that, Lord, you care about the details of our life. If we could count up the number of thoughts you have toward us, they would outnumber the sand on the seashore. God, we thank you that you care so much for us. We love you. We give you praise. We give you honor. We lift your name up, Jesus, because it's all about you. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Let's go ahead and take a seat, and would you please warmly welcome Pastor Josh? Is he going to come teach the word?
Thank you so much, Pastor Greg. How y'all doing this morning? Yeah, you feel alive? You feel ready to get into the Word of God? I just wonder who in this place this morning has a reason to praise God. I wonder who has been healed, who has been set free, who has seen their life go from darkness and be put into light, who has seen hopeless situations turn into hopeful situations, who has seen the things meant for evil turn for good. I wonder if you have some reason to praise God this morning. I sure do, and I'm so glad to be here with you. My name's Josh. I'm a pastor here on staff at The Cross, and my wife and I have been here for just a short period of time, about 5 months. If you're new to The Cross, by the way, you need to come back, and you need to hear Pastor Greg, because he is such a great preacher, such a great communicator and pastor, and so you need to be back to hear from him as he shares God's word. But, you know, my wife and I, we've been here for about 5 months, and I feel the need to remind you that this is actually a pretty cool place. South Florida, there's a reason that there's so many people here, right? I mean, we hate traffic. We hate all this stuff, the mean people that are all around. But come on, South Florida is pretty amazing. This is coming from a guy, yes, that you have a reason to be thankful. Coming from a guy who spent 8 years of his life in the frigid tundra of Montana. Spending a winter here in Florida is definitely a blessing from the Lord. Can I get an amen? Yeah. So you have a reason to be thankful, even though it can be hard at times. My wife and I, we got to go up to Universal in Orlando last week. We did what Pastor Greg recommended, and we did a little getaway. We got to go up there, and it just reminded me, man, this place is so awesome, and it's such a privilege to be here. Over the Christmas holiday, my wife and I, we got to go to Disney. For the first time ever, we went to Disney World. Now, I know for you guys who live down here, that's no big thing at all. It's like, oh, yeah, Disney, what's the big deal? I go there every other weekend. Well, for us, we had never been to Disney World. We'd been to other Disney places, but not Disney World. Disney World is the best, I got to say. It takes the cake. I mean, it's better than every other Disney park. It's just incredible. And so we went up there, and we were at Disney Springs. I don't know if you've been into Disney Springs. It's kind of newer in the last few years. They've upped it, renovated it. It's like incredible. All these stores, all these shops, all these restaurants. We go there. We go to get our Disney tickets, and we're going to spend Christmas up there. My wife and I were here without any family, and we're like, hey, why don't we go up there, spend some time at Christmas. Pastor Greg was there with his family. And so we're hanging out at Disney. We go to the Guest Relations Center to buy our tickets, and we were declined. Our card got declined. And we're like, oh, my gosh. And it was such a bummer of a moment. We're like, oh, we don't know what we're going to do. And so the lady who's helping us, she goes, wait just a second. She goes to the back. She comes back. She's like, hey, fill out this form. I'm like, okay, fill out this form. She leaves. She comes back. She says, hey, you know what? Merry Christmas. And she gives us two free park hopper passes to Disney World for Christmas Day. How amazing is that, right? Yeah, you can clap for that. That's like, you know, several hundred dollars worth of a gift to us that we didn't deserve, that we didn't earn. We had done nothing in order to get that or receive it, but it was just given to us. And I wonder if you understand this morning the power of generosity. The power of generosity. When somebody goes out of their way of their own expense to give you something, to bless you, to help you, do you understand the kind of impact that that has in your life? Generosity is a powerful thing. And that's what I want to talk to you about this morning, this life-giving, life-changing truth that can really turn your world and other people's worlds upside down, the power of generosity. Because when you start to be generous, you have the ability to set people free. You have the ability to let people know that they're loved. You have the ability to see someone who doesn't even know that other people know what's happening in their life to feel like they're known and they're cared for. Generosity can break chains. It can open people's eyes. It can set people free. There's power in generosity. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. If you have a Bible, you can turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4. That's where we're going to be at, 1 Timothy chapter 4. And you can also get on, you know, if you have a phone that has Wi-Fi, you can get on your Bible there. Why don't we pray? God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you that you're faithful and that you're good. Lord, we pray this morning that you would speak to us powerfully through your word. God, I pray that you would open our eyes to see incredible things in your word. And I pray that we would walk out of this room different than how we came in. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We'll get to 1 Timothy 4 in just a second, but the dictionary defines generosity like this. It says, the quality of being kind and generous. Oh, thanks, dictionary. You just used the same word that you're defining. You know, like, how do they get away with that? Generosity means being generous. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, the second definition is the quality or fact of being plentiful or large. Now, some of you are like, well, I don't want generosity then. Diet, right? I don't want to be plentiful or large. It's the last thing I need. No, generosity is not about your physical size, but it's about the size of your life. It's about the quality of your life. You see, generosity is not just about your finances, although it does include, I believe, your finances, but it's about how you serve. It's about how you spend your time. It's about how you love other people. It's about how you give of yourself. Generosity should be our way of life in our time, our talent, and our treasure. Our time, our talent, and our treasure. Why don't you turn to somebody sitting next to you and say, I'm generous. Now turn to that other person on the other side who knows that they're your second choice and tell them, I'm so glad I'm have fun this morning. Generosity. I want to be known for generosity in my life. And I think we all are known for something in our life, right? Whether or not we realize it, when your name comes up, people have adjectives that go with it. Loving, kind, gracious, patient, or other things that maybe could pop into their mind. Stingy, frustrated, angry. Hopefully those adjectives don't describe our life. But we all have things when we come to people that they associate with us. Well, I think that God wants us to be generous people and to be known for our generosity. When you come to someone's mind, is generous a word that they associate with you? I think that that's what God wants for us. 1 Timothy 6, we'll start in verse 17. God tells us to be generous here. He says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty. This doesn't mean like don't be a hottie. It means like don't be proud. I know we don't use hottie a lot in our language today. Nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly provides everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. Now I know what you're thinking. This verse is written to rich people, right? I'm not rich. I'm not wealthy. Well, hold on a second. By whose standard? If you compare how we live to how you are quite rich. If you compare our total wealth to people in other countries, $645. In Africa, not much higher, $5,080. In America, the average wealth is well over $100,000. Isn't it crazy compared to the rest of the world? You can't say that we're not rich. Even if you're here in America, you might have so much more than people in other countries. So we can be generous. We are rich. It's not an excuse that tells us to be generous. Why? Well, first of all, and this is our first point this morning, generosity is God's predisposition. Generosity is God's predisposition. Predisposition means like your nature, right? How you are kind of naturally. Anybody know somebody who's just, they're kind of predisposed genetically to being in shape? Don't you hate those people? You know? You're like, oh my gosh, you can eat so much and you're still a twig. My father-in-law, he has like the metabolism of a gopher or something. Like he just eats, he never gets any bigger. Like how come I didn't get that genetic trait, right? See, we're predisposed, whether it's genetically or with character traits, we're naturally a certain way. God's predisposition is generosity. God is a generous God that richly provides for us. We just read in 1 Timothy. How can he richly provide for us? Because he's rich. God is the richest of the rich. In fact, the Bible says that he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Now, hold on. If you're like me, you're like, oh, great. God owns a bunch of cows. Like, why is that such a good thing? Like, what's God's fascination with cows? Is he a dairy farmer? What's the deal with him? He's so excited about cows. Well, back in the Old Testament, your livestock was what was associated, or one of the things that was associated with your wealth, right? So if you have more animals, more livestock, then you're incredibly wealthy. God owns all the cattle on 1,000 hills. It's like saying God owns the money in all of the banks. God is rich. Compared to God, Donald Trump looks poor. Compared to God, Bill Gates doesn't have anything. Compared to God, you could even go back to King Solomon, who was probably the wealthiest man who's ever lived, and say, compared to God, they don't even have anything. God owns it all. He's rich. And it's out of this richness that he generously provides for us. Now, I'm not just talking about money here. I'm talking about his generous grace. I'm talking about his generous love. He's got a treasure trove of mercy that he wants to pour out into your life. God is generous and rich in every way, able to meet every need of your life. Exodus 34, 6, it says this, and the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and, check it out, abounding in goodness and truth. Catch that adjective? Abounding in goodness and truth. Or maybe that's a different form of or phrase in speech. I'm sorry if it's not an adjective, grammar teachers. Let's go to another verse. This next verse, Ephesians 2, 7. It says, in him we have redemption, 1, 7 and 8. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Do you get the idea that God is a generous God? He doesn't give you just enough. He doesn't make you barely scrape by. He abundantly provides more than you could even ask or think. That's why Ephesians 3:20, the theme verse or the main verse for this entire church, Ephesians 3:20, it says this, now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Man, isn't that amazing? God can do exceedingly abundantly according to all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Wow, that's some power that's working inside of us. I like to say that God is the God of the LY. It means when God does something, you're most likely going to have to add a word in front of it, and it's going to end in the letters LY. Exceedingly, abundantly, supernaturally, miraculously, amazingly, holy, holy, holy. God is the God of the LY. He's got mad style, y'all. He's rolling deep. He is in no need for anything. He's not stingy. He has no shortage of anything. And I wonder this morning, how many of you know that your God is, in fact, a generous God? Who can say, man, God has given me more than I ever needed. God has given me more than I ever deserved. And God will never lack in giving me everything that I need. This is the God that we serve. And why? Why is he so generous? Why does he richly provide us all things? Well, 1 Timothy, it tells us. It says he provides richly to us all things. This is talking about our stuff. To enjoy. To enjoy. And sorry, not just our stuff. Every area that he provides for us. He wants us to be blessed. You see, God gives stuff to you. Gives blessings to you just so that you can enjoy them. God loves to give gifts to his kids. What I'm trying to say is don't feel bad for being blessed by God. Can you imagine if you were to give your child something, a gift, because you knew they wanted something, and so you get them a bike, and they're like, oh, thank you so much, and then they put it in a corner, and they're like, well, I kind of feel guilty. I didn't really deserve that bike, and so I'm not really going to ride it. I hope you don't, I don't want anything to get in the way of me and you, and so I'm just going to leave this bike over here. What? You got the bike so that your kid would enjoy it, right? God gives you gifts so that you can enjoy them. Don't feel bad about the abundance and the blessing that he pours out on your life. In fact, you're going to bring him more glory by enjoying what he gives you than by trying to get rid of it or being stingy with it, right? Enjoy the things that God's put in your life. And when you think about everything he's done for you, how he's lavished his grace and his mercy on you, how he's forgiven you of every wrong thing you've ever done, how he's changed your life and taken you from darkness into light and given you his love and his truth. I wonder, when you think about that, doesn't that just make you want to be generous to other people? Doesn't that make you want to pour out the generosity that God has poured into you? See, God richly provides for you so that you can richly provide for other people. God blesses you so that you can be a blessing to other people. God lavishes his mercy on you so you can lavish mercy on other people. And so we see that generosity is God's predisposition, but because it is, then our second point is that generosity is our privilege. Generosity is our privilege. Because God's given us so much, it's a privilege to be able to give things out to others, right? See, this doesn't make sense to our world, though. Even though Jesus said it's more blessed to give than to receive, you know, he said it's actually more blessed. You're like, how does that even work? Because it's pretty good to get. I don't know about you, but I like getting me some gifts. If somebody gets me a nice gift for my birthday or just shows up randomly with a nice gift at any point in time, even right now, I'm happy. I'm happy to get a gift. It's pretty good to get a gift, right? But giving a gift, when you know that somebody is really in need of something or they really want something and you get them that gift and you're waiting, you can't even wait to give it to them, right? Sometimes you have to jump ahead and be like, this is supposed to be a surprise, but here you go. It's October, but I know Christmas is like 2 months away, but I got this for you, you know? It's more blessed to give than to receive, but that doesn't make any sense in our culture, though, because our culture esteems and values just the opposite. Our culture values greed. Greed is actually encouraged in our culture. Get as much as you can for yourself, and then once you get it, even if you have to lie and cheat and steal and step on other people so that you can have it, then you need to hold on to it, you need to invest it, and you need to not give any of it away. You need to keep yourself as number one. And if you do give, it's just kind of to make you feel better. But greed is espoused by people in our culture. And not just with finances, greed with our time, greed with our resources, greed with our appearance, greed with getting on social media and making it all about us, like me, like me, like me. I want to be the most popular. I want to be the most liked. And then we actually value when other people do that and esteem them and worship them. Our culture values greed. So generosity doesn't make sense in our world. It confounds people when we as believers in Jesus are generous. I know someone who went to their financial advisor. This is a couple who had been blessed with finances. They wanted to give a large portion of their income or whatever to their church. I don't know the exact number, but their financial advisor was like, I don't think that's a good idea, right? Because if you're just living for this world and you're only living based on what you can see and smell and touch and feel, it doesn't make sense to be generous. You should hold on to everything. You should make sure it doesn't get away and that you don't lose it. But if you're living with an eternal perspective, if you realize that this world is not all that there is, that we're actually investing into eternity, and that we're going to be dead but alive in heaven way longer than we're going to be alive, then it makes so much sense then to be generous. Because all of us will live forever in one place or another, hopefully heaven. But as we give and we're generous, we're laying up for ourselves what's coming, a foundation for what's coming ahead, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. But if you want to experience all the blessing that God has for you, if you want to understand the privilege of generosity, then it's going to come through giving and not through keeping. How many know that the more you keep, the less you experience God's blessing? And the more you give, the more you experience his blessing. Now again, I'm not just talking about finances, although I think it includes that. But I'm talking about when you give of your time, when you give of your attention, when you give to other people in whatever way that you feel like you should give to them, you see the blessing that comes from that. It actually becomes addictive. You're like, I can't wait to do that more. How many of you have taken time maybe on a holiday or something like that? You've gone to like a homeless shelter, you've served. It's like, oh man, this is so good. It's so good to give back. It is true what Jesus said. It's more blessed to give than to receive. And the more that you do it, the more that you want to do it. So when it comes to experiencing God's blessings, we need to get frozen up in here. Let it go. Let it go. Sorry, parents. God wants you to be blessed. He wants you to experience every blessing that he has for you. If that includes your finances, then awesome, because I believe God does want to bless your finances, but also every area of your life, your relationships, your love life, your work. God wants you to be blessed in every area. So God's not up in heaven twisting your arm, trying to get you to give. He wants to bless you. And if you hold on to stuff with a closed fist, God can't put anything in there, right? But it's when you open up your hand and you say, God, I'm going to let your blessings flow out from my life, and I'm going to keep my hand open for what blessings you want to pour in to my life, that you really get to experience the blessing of generosity. Man, I would much rather live with an open hand and God controls what goes in and what comes out than I would with a closed fist. And all of us have the ability to be generous regardless of our income, of our talents, of our abilities. We all have something we can be generous with. You see, generosity expands your world. Greed shrinks your world. Proverbs 11, 24 through 26 says this: the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. The people will curse him who withholds grain, but blessing will be on the head of him who sells it. And my God shall supply. Oh, that's another verse. We'll get there in just a second. I love how the Message puts Proverbs 11, 24 and 26. Listen to this. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. Wow. You see, the more that you are generous, you are seeing your world expand. And the more that you're greedy, the more you're seeing your world shrink. And that comes to, again, every area of life. The more you're generous, the more you're going to see your sphere of influence expand, your relationships expand, every area of your life expand. And the more you are stingy, your world's just going to get smaller and smaller until you're not able to enjoy anything. And even the people that are around you, you're not able to enjoy them as much, because it's in sharing what we have that we really experience the enjoyment of life. So generosity expands your world. Generosity extends God's kingdom. How many know that we all want to be a part of something bigger than ourselves, right? We're all longing to be a part of something that's going to make a difference, that's going to live on after we're gone. Why do you think so many people get involved in these big causes around the world? They want to be involved in something that's bigger than themselves. Well, guess what? Through being generous, you get to be involved in something much bigger than yourself. You get to be a part of expanding the kingdom of God. Through giving of your time, of your talent, of your treasure, you're helping the blind see. You're helping those who were imprisoned in sin to be set free. You're helping those who were hopeless to have hope, those filled with anxiety to have peace, those who were wandering in darkness to experience the light. When you give and you're generous, you are expanding the kingdom of God. And you know where you can start with that? Right here at the Cross Church. Man, if you are not involved here, if you're not serving with your time, if you're not investing with your treasure, if you're not using your talent, you're only ripping yourself off and all of us. Because we could experience the blessing that God's given you in a way that blesses us. And then as you give, you find it's more blessed to give than to receive. So if you aren't involved, I would encourage you, get involved. This isn't some heavy-handed guilt trip. I'm just saying, as God leads you, get plugged in. Serve. Find the blessing of being generous in all of those areas. Generosity, it's a privilege. Lastly, the reason that generosity is a privilege is because it frees you from greed. It frees you from greed. Have you noticed that the more you wrap your hand tightly around your possessions, that you find out that your possessions are possessing you. You're now becoming obsessed with your stuff. You're feeling like you have to do everything you can to make sure that nobody else takes it. You're worried about how you're going to maintain the current level of life that you have, and you're becoming more and more obsessed with your stuff. That's why 1 Timothy, it says, don't put your hope in the uncertainty of riches. My goodness, if there's anything uncertain in this world, it's riches, right? Here one moment and gone the next. Ask people who went through the Great Recession, all of us, or the Great Depression, or just live in a life where they're watching money flow up and down. You never can rely on how much something's going to be worth, on how much you're going to make. You just don't know, right? Ultimately, riches are uncertain. Don't put your hope in riches. If you do, you'll be disappointed. But God says, put your hope in me who provides. Did you know that whatever income you have, whatever blessings you have in your life, that those weren't things that you just earned yourself, but it was God who provided those things for you? Well, I've got so much talent. I worked really hard. I'm intelligent. I'm cunning. Well, that's great. Who gave you the intelligence? How did you get so cunning and crafty? How did you work so hard if it wasn't for a desire that had been placed in your heart and an ability to go out and earn and make money? It's God who's provided for you. It's not you and your ability. And so don't put your hope in your riches. Put your hope in God who provides. Because ultimately we get greedy because we're trusting in ourselves, right? That's at the root of greed, is we just trust us. We don't know how, if we spend this money or give this money, or if we spend this time or give this time, how we're going to be able to get it back and how we're going to be able to improve ourselves. We're just trying to make sure that we can do everything on our end to maintain what we have instead of trusting in God. So here's the cure for greed: generosity. God's given you a cure to make sure that greed doesn't get its roots down deep in your heart. And it's through giving your things, your talent, your time, your treasure away. You see, God wants us to enjoy things, but not be enamored with things. He doesn't want us to worship our stuff. He wants us to use our stuff to worship him. Amen? All right, point number three. You guys are tracking with me? Yeah? You guys all look like you're tracking with me. Thanks. I know we're talking about generosity, and now we're talking about finances. I know it can be uncomfortable to talk about finances, especially in church, but here's the deal. We're not out to get your money, right? We're out for God to get your heart. But your money and your heart are very intertwined. That's why Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So God doesn't need your money. You know, we're not trying to get your money. God wants your heart. And so he says, give so that money doesn't have your heart. I have your heart. In Philippians 4:19, I love this verse. It's one of the most popular verses in the Bible. It says, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Let me read it again. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. You see, this church in Philippi was one of Paul's, like, he loved these guys. They were with him through thick and thin. They supported him no matter what, even when it was very hard and difficult for them. You have a friend like that, somebody who just sticks with you no matter what? That's the Philippian church. They were so generous with Paul. And then as a result, Paul gets to this verse in chapter 4:19, and then he says, my God shall supply all your need. You see, this isn't some random verse that anybody can apply to their life. So many people take this out of context. This is a verse that's intended for those who are generous. It's saying, as you give, God is going to make sure that you're provided for. You don't have to worry about it as long as you're sacrificially giving toward God's kingdom. You see, God wants to provide for you. You could say that the road to provision is paved with generosity. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not advocating like some scheme or tactic where, oh, you know, you give $1,000 to the church and you're going to get a $10,000 check and here's your Lamborghini. That would be nice, though. I wouldn't mind driving a Lamborghini. Hello. My goodness, when I lived in Montana, I saw one Lamborghini, I think, ever there. I saw it a couple times, but it was like finding a unicorn. Then you get down to Miami, And it's like, there's a Lamborghini dealership. I didn't even know that they had dealerships. I thought they just like showed up at your door with the Lamborghini, you know? Anyway, what I'm talking about here is that God wants you to give because as you give, you can be sure that he's going to provide. Now, I'm not advocating some legalistic guilt trip, you know, where you need to make sure to do this or that, but I'm saying as you're faithful to obey how God tells you to give, you can trust that he's going to provide. And if you're looking for a place to start, here's what I'd recommend to you, is the tithe. The tithe. Maybe you're familiar with this concept, maybe you aren't. But the tithe is 10% of your income. The Hebrew word for it just means a tenth. And back in the Old Testament, they would give 10% of their all their possessions and wealth so that the priests could be taken care of and the temple and the tabernacle could be taken care of. And this principle was actually in place even before because Abraham, who was before the nation of Israel, he tithed 10% of his stuff to a guy named Melchizedek, who was a picture of Jesus. So the idea is giving 10% of my finances, of my stuff, to God. Now, again, this isn't some legalistic thing, you have to do it, but it ensures that greed, again, doesn't take hold in your heart. Because 10% of your money isn't God's, 100% of your money is God's, right? But God's saying, give me 10 so that you know that the 100's from me. Because when you hold on to the 100, you start to think it's from you and not from him. And you start to trust in it. And so I'd rather give 10 and have him bless the 90 than keep 100 and not have his blessing on it. Man, it is so much better to give than to receive. And you will never be able to outgive God. Man, when you give to him, you will find that he gives back to you. That is always true. I remember one time, there was a time I was really kind of growing and giving, and I felt like God was challenging me to give off of this gift that I had received. And I was like, man, I don't know if I need to give on that because it was a gift, right? And yeah, that was foolish thinking. And then I was like, you know, I felt like God was telling me, you need to give on this. So I gave, I tithed on the gift that was given to me. I got home, no joke. From that day, I got a check for the same amount from this like Bank of America. I had like an account with them like 8 years ago. And they're like, oh, we forgot we owed you this money. What? See, you can never outgive God. Whenever he tells you to give, the best thing to do is to obey. And you will find that you are never, or he is never your debtor. You might think, man, it's really a stretch to give right now. It's really hard to give. I can't afford to give. You can't afford not to give. Man, you need to give to ensure that God is going to provide. And if God's stretching you in giving, it's because I believe he's getting ready to bless you. So give, and you will see yourself led to God's provision. It's not about amount, you know? It's about the heart behind it, and it's about making sure that you're obeying and being generous. And the tithe, the 10%, is a good place to start. You may have heard the story of the widow in Luke 21, who she didn't have much money, and she came up to give her offering, and all the people before her had all this pomp and circumstance celebrating how much they were giving and how awesome they were, and they were putting their money in the box and whatever and parading how awesome and incredible they were. And then this lady comes up and she gives two mites, the widow's mite. You may have heard this story, which was the equivalent of very little money. I don't know the exact amount, but it was like a buck or 2 bucks or less. And she puts it in. And Jesus says, do you see that woman? She gave more than all the rest because that was all that she had. You see, God's not looking for you to come and drop some big paycheck. He's just looking for you to give back out of what he's given you. And he sees what you need to sacrifice to give to him, and he will always reward that. So generosity leads to God's provision. And lastly, I'll call the worship team up here to help me close this thing down. Generosity is preparation for the future. I don't know if you heard this story about a guy who had the chance to be not one of, but a very, very wealthy man. He was one of the original founders of Apple. This story is so sad. Ron Wayne was this guy's name, right? Ron Wayne, one of the original founders of Apple, sold his shares in Apple in 1976 for $800. Why? Well, he didn't like Steve Jobs, He felt like he was pretty rude and mean and cold, and he didn't want to be around him. He said, you know what? I'm going to cash out right now. If Ron Wayne had kept his shares, you know how much it would be worth today? $35 billion. Man, he's probably kicking himself right now, right? What I want to tell you this morning is you have a chance today to invest into something that's going to reap a reward for eternity. And the return on investment is going to be significantly greater than anything you put in right now. And it's called laying up for yourself treasures in heaven. 1 Timothy, again, it talks about this. And it says in verse 19, chapter 6, verse 19, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future. You're able, through what you give right now, not just finances, again, everywhere that you give, because Timothy tells us to be rich in good works. So how you're rich and generous in your time and your talent and your treasure, you're laying up for yourself right now a foundation for what you're going to enjoy for eternity. How many know it would be a wise investment to put as much into that account as possible right now? I know that that's where we should be investing. Because you're going to get to heaven. How many builders know this is true? What if you were to, you know, get to a job site, you builders, and you have all your materials, you have all your stuff, you're ready to build this massive building. You get there, you realize there's no foundation. We haven't dug down deep. We haven't laid a strong foundation. Well, you're not going to be able to build a building without a strong foundation, right? Well, you have a chance right now to lay a strong foundation for eternity in heaven through laying up for yourself treasures there. God's got something for you in the future. And if you're generous, you'll be able to experience a beautiful foundation. How can you send stuff ahead? Well, by what we talked about. Being rich in good works. Serving others. Putting others ahead of yourselves. Getting involved right here at the Cross Church. If you're not on a team, today's the day to get involved in a team. Because you're only ripping yourself off. You're not experiencing the community of serving with other people. You're not experiencing the blessing it is to see this place come together and then get broke down and then people come in here and find life and hope in Jesus Christ. You need to start laying up for yourself treasures in heaven. Did you know that if everybody in here, every person were to start serving, that we probably still wouldn't have enough people? I know a lot of times we think, well, you know, they're going to take care of it. Other people are going to take care of it. If all of us served, we'd still need more. But what happens is just a small percentage of the overall church serves, and then we put more and more on those people because nobody else is stepping up to serve, and those people get overwhelmed and burdened and burn out because it takes all of us working together to see this place function how it should. Now, again, I'm not trying to lay a guilt trip on you. I'm just saying if you're not serving, you're missing out on what God has for you. I love how Jesus said to lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust don't destroy and where thieves can't break in and steal. You see, everything that you lay up for yourself on this earth is susceptible to being stolen, to withering away, to getting rusted out, to not being there anymore because there's a fire, there's a tornado, there's a hurricane. It's only what you invest into eternity that's secure. That can't be stolen, that no one can take away, that no thief can break in and steal. And so I think I would much rather put my resources and my time, my talent into getting ready for that than to just living for what's here on earth. So be generous. Be generous. And you're going to see God's blessing in your life like never before. There is power. There is power in generosity. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your word that speaks to us, that communicates your love to us, that shows us your truth and your grace. Lord, I pray that this morning we would become that church that you want us to be, that we would become that generous church that can't wait to give of everything that we have so that other people can know you, so that other people can be encouraged, so that lives can be changed. Lord, I pray that we would not be stingy and greedy, but we'd open up our hand to receive and let flow from everything that you want to do in our lives. While we're praying, while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, this verse that we read in 1 Timothy, it closed off saying, command these people to be generous so that they can lay hold of that which is true life. True life. Did you know that true life is found in Jesus? It's not found in anything in this world. The Bible says eternity has been placed in our hearts, meaning that we have a longing for a connection with God that's inherent in our nature. And that's why nothing in this earth can satisfy us. No amount of money, no amount of stuff, no amount of sex, no amount of power, relationship, none of that can ultimately satisfy us. Only Jesus can satisfy the deepest needs of our heart. And when we find him, we lay hold of that which is true life. And I wonder if there's anyone here this morning who you don't have yet a relationship with Jesus. You haven't started walking with him. You thought that you had to earn your way to him, or you've been trying to do all these good works so that he'll be happy with you, or you're just bogged down with shame and guilt and you don't know how to get rid of it. Well, all of the answers to those questions are found in Jesus Christ. He died for you so that you could live. And you don't have to do anything to earn your way to him. He did it all for you by dying at the cross to pay for every wrong thing that you've ever done and to give you a new start and eternal life. And I wonder if there's anyone here this morning who would say, yes, Josh, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to lay hold of that which is true life. If that's you this morning, while heads are bowed and while eyes are closed, could you just raise your hand so that I could pray for you? This is a moment between you and God, but I just want to pray for you as you make this commitment to follow Christ and to put him first and to lay hold of that which is true life. Anybody in here and say, yeah, Josh, that's me. I need to lay hold of that which is ultimately real life. Awesome. Awesome. Well, anyone who's making that decision this morning, I just want to lead you in a prayer. And this, there's nothing magical about this. This is just putting words into what you're hopefully experiencing in your heart, putting your faith in Christ. So just pray this prayer after me. If you're watching on Facebook, you can do the same thing. Say, dear God, I know that I'm a sinner. I ask for your forgiveness. Come into my heart. Make me a new person. You are the Lord of my life, and I give my life to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can we celebrate with those who are making that decision this morning? So amazing. Well, if you made that decision today, or even if you're just newer in your walk with God, or you just want to go to the next level in your walk with him, we've got something for you right after church. It's called the Grow Course, and it's going to take place in the kids ministry classroom right over here as you're leaving, right to my right, your left. We're going to have lunch in there, and today we're going to be talking about the importance of being plugged into community and church. We'd love to have you there. It's 4 weeks altogether, but you can jump in at any time. And then it will start again after that 4 weeks is over. And next week, we have a welcome party here that you heard about. Brandon and Cassie did a great job with announcements earlier, told you about the upcoming welcome party. If you're new to the Cross, you'd like to meet Pastor Greg or the team, find out how you can get more plugged in or what the church is all about, come next week, right after church. We'll have food, we'll hang out, and you can find out more about the Cross. I think we should close with some worship. That sound good? Awesome. Keith and Sephora, why don't you lead us?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Chosen me, love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Yeah, let's give Jesus a hand for the strength he gives. What a great message, huh, by Josh. Would you please just give the Lord some praise? My heart is that we would be a church that would take that message and apply it and go out of this church and be generous with his love that he's poured into your heart, his grace that he's given to you and I, his forgiveness that he's poured out to you, And whatever he has given you, that you would just say, Lord, it's all yours. However you want me to do it, I want to be generous with you. And as we can impact a community, I believe, by your generosity. Amen? A great word from Josh. We're so excited. Let's go out and be generous people. Amen. Let's do that. God bless you guys. Thank you for being here.